Welcome to American Literature Daily. I'm your local host, Michelle McHilson, and our guest today is Dr. Alice Godzewski from Belgium.
Thank you, Dr. Michelle. It's good to be here.
Today, we'll talk about two authors, one of which looks scarier than his stories, and another one who was so depressed that his life became a major plot hole like his stories. No, you guessed wrong. It's neither Shakespeare nor Mykola Gogol. This is called American Literature Daily, and we're going to talk about Edgar Allan Poe and Henry James.
And if you don't know who they are, you're good at math.
Our first piece of literature is going to be about The Fall of the House of Usher by Edgar Allan Poe.
That's marvelous, Dr. Michelle. Let's jump right into the story.
Of course. The story revolves around our main character, Roderick, who suffers from a mental illness and asks his friend for a visit to their old creepy house. But what the narrator wasn't expecting was Roderick's sister Madeline's awakening from the sleep of death.
Sleep of death? So was she dead or alive?
Yes.
Okay. Can you tell us a bit more about the story?
Sure. Basically, our unnamed narrator receives a letter from Roderick asking him to visit Roderick's old family estate, which appears in the story to have a symbolic meaning. The narrator went over to his house, and when he arrived, he noticed that the house had a lot of cracks, as if it was on the edge of collapsing, and the rest of the surrounding highlighted the sorrow and fear around the house.
Remember, kids, if your friend, who lives alone, is sick, and it's been a gazillion years since you've last heard from him, asks you all of a sudden to go and visit his house, you don't just wake up in the middle of the night and say, hey, I'm going to go visit my pal, who I haven't seen in a really long time, and who probably has coronavirus.
Anyways, long story short, my main man Roderick goes bonkers and starts doing random things, and our narrator sits and observes, because he was not just a clown, he was the entire circus.
Such a dramatic circus.
Right. So at one point, Roderick tells the narrator about this sickness that runs in the family, his sister's bad condition and how he is worried about her. He believed that his family estate was cursed and was the cause of their sickness. Soon, this little conversation turns into a therapy session in which Roderick talks about his fear of death and the narrator tries to comfort him.
Was he a believer?
How would I know? I've never met the guy. Anyways, at one point, Madeline stops breathing.
You mean dies?
Well, yes, but actually no. The narrator and Roderick carry Madeline's lifeless body into a chamber and they put her in a coffin there. Then they lock her in the room that has a very thick iron door.
Why didn't they just bury her?
They probably watched that cheesy commercial about coffins. Again, how would I know?
Okay then, but what commercial though?
You'll probably see it. Maybe it'll air.
I don't know about you, but I wouldn't want to be in her position.
Really? I'd love to be carried around by two guys to my deathbed rather than dying alone in the arms of an old lady, if you know what I mean. As I was saying, after putting her in the coffin, Roderick's fears worsened. And one of those nights, when the weather was terrible, dark and full of terrors, Roderick came into the narrator's room claiming he had heard weird sounds which were from Madeline.
Oh, Dr. Michelle, I'm assuming this wasn't a one-time thing, was it?
No, it wasn't. He had been constantly hearing unexplained sounds until that night Madeline appeared with her white bloody dress, not quite dead, but not alive either.
How did she wake?
Who knows? As soon as she saw him, she fell in his arms and died.
How did Roderick react when she died again?
He got so scared he parted from life.
And the narrator?
The narrator realized that the sickness that runs in the family wasn't corona after all. And so our narrator runs away like you would run to get the last piece of toilet paper at the store. And as he ran away from the house, he saw it collapse, symbolizing the fall of the Usher family.
What a story, Dr. Michelle. If you don't mind, I'm going to analyze the elements of it.
Please go ahead.
The Fall of the House of Usher by Edgar Allan Poe belongs to the Gothic literature genre. The Gothic style is clearly visible from the beginning of the story, when we come across dark and mysterious elements. The place where Usher lives is a big old house in the middle of nowhere, which belonged to the same family for decades. It is surrounded by dead trees and a gloomy, quiet lake. The house was very dark, with huge eye-like windows and big rooms with a bright red light coming through it. The red color symbolizes petrifying emotions and intensity. The whole setting of the story establishes mystery and suspense that is enhanced by a plot which seeks to discover the secrets lying within the supernaturally charged environment. Another gothic element is the highly altered emotional state of the characters. In the story, the characters constantly experience feelings of terror, confusion, anger, and obsessive love, just like Roderick's exaggerated concern and anxiousness towards his sister Madeleine, or Roderick's disturbed psychological state. Throughout the whole story, we can see clues about ghosts and unexplained sounds, doors opening themselves, which are all part of Gothic literature. Madeleine's sudden appearance enhances the impression that Poe's work is a classic example of Gothic literature.
Thank you, Dr. Elise. And now a little commercial break. We'll be right back.
Are you existential? Do you think about life and death a lot? Well, we can't help you on that matter. But what we can guarantee, though, is that your eternal rest will be absolutely worth it. For only $49.99, Frederick's Coffins, with its beautiful, feathered, silky cushions installed on some real good Lyptus wood, will guarantee that you will not want to open your eyes. $49.99! You said it, sister! And speaking about sisters, Frederick's Coffins are so good that you'll probably want to bury your sister alive, if you know what I'm saying. So what are you waiting for? The stocks are running low, so put your sisters in the chambers, because we're running out of extras. $49.99!
Welcome back, our beloved audience. Again, I'm Michelle, and we have Dr. Elise with us.
So for now, we are going to talk about our second piece of literature by Henry James, The Turn of the Screw. The story is told by our narrator, and governess.
Wait, you said narrator twice.
I know.
Anyways, could you tell us when and where this story takes place?
I'm not quite sure, but some people decided to gather on Christmas Eve and tell ghost stories.
Wait, isn't that for Halloween?
Haven't you seen The Nightmare Before Christmas?
Oh.
Exactly. So our first unknown narrator describes our second narrator, Douglas, that describes our third narrator, which is the governess.
Okay. Who is Douglas and who is the governess?
Douglas is the guy who decided it's a good idea to tell ghost stories on Christmas Eve.
Not what I meant. I was asking about the identity.
Well, stupidity is also a part of a person's identity.
Can't argue.
Anyways, the governess used to work for Douglas's sister after the events of the story happened.
Huh. So that's how he knew the story.
Yes, you're right. But he actually managed to tell the story because he had the story written by the governess. When she was working for Douglas's sister, she told him about her last job opportunity offered by a handsome bachelor.
Oh, where?
Have a guess.
At an isolated house in the middle of nowhere?
Precisely, but not exactly. It was in Essex House Bly.
Oh, is that in Great Britain?
Yes.
Why there?
Well, because of the quarantine, and Great Britain has a fee of 120 euros if you get out of the house. You can never be too careful.
Good point.
So, of course, the governess takes the job and arrives at Bly. She is welcomed by Mrs. Gross, who apparently is the housekeeper, and lives with two children, a brother named Miles and a sister named Flora.
Foreign main character, check. Isolated house, check. Brother and sister, check.
Oh, that's not all. Things are about to get screwed from here.
Lovely.
So the governess meets with those people, first the housekeeper and Flora, but Miles isn't there yet. He appears in the story after they receive a message that he got expelled from school.
Oh no, what happened?
We don't know what he did for sure, but what we do know is that she thinks Miles and Flora were angelic and innocent.
As most children are.
You should see mine.
I bet they're lovely.
They sure are. Anyways, the governess asks about the previous employee who used to work before her. The housekeeper, of course, is a very honorable woman, and she mentions how she doesn't like to talk about other people's business. So throughout the story, our dear governess tries to understand what happened with Miles at school. And he tells her he did things that upset them, but never specifies what he actually did.
Does anyone clarify anything in this story?
Believe me, we're just getting started. The governess has her first encounter with a ghost.
Another ghost? What is it with these supernatural storylines?
In case you forgot, Dr. Michelle, our theme for today is Gothic. So naturally, our first ghost, Mr. Quint, was a former employee of Bly.
Okay, we're getting there. How are we introduced to these characters?
She just sees the guy from the window basking in his ghostly glory, hands on the ledge, and as we all wait for something to happen, nothing happens.
Well, that's a bummer.
Not really, as she encountered the ghosts many times.
Ghosts? Wasn't one bad enough?
No, it seems like Binary is the go-to of our dear authors. Apparently, there is another one, the spirit of the previous governess.
What about the others? Don't they witness the ghosts?
No, they were in denial and pretended that everything was A-okay. Soon, she started doubting their innocence because of their weird behavior.
So, didn't she tell anyone about this issue?
She did. The governess constantly discussed it with Mrs. Gross, but nothing significant came out of it.
Didn't the governess think of calling the Ghostbusters?
Nope, she didn't. So the rest of the story was basically the governess getting visited by ghosts and doubting the children's innocence. At one point, she starts getting mad and takes the mantle of the detective.
Governess Holmes?
Yes. She confronts Miles and asks him about his suspicious behavior at school. His only response is that some of his actions made the school officials angry.
Did our ghosts have anything to do with that?
We never really find out. That is one of the questions that remains unanswered in the story. However, when the governess and Miles are in this intense conversation, the ghost suddenly shows up and makes a little birthday wish by blowing out the candle in the room. At first, the governess thinks it's Miles, but then she acknowledges the presence of the ghost, and that's when Miles dies unexpectedly.
What does he die from exactly?
Don't you love us, Miles? Don't you want to stay with us? Tell him you want him to go!
Go! I want you to go!
This is one of the questions that again remains a mystery.
And what happened to Flora?
She got sick and Mrs. Gross took her away from Bly.
Okay, so we don't know what happened with Miles at school, nor do we know how he died. So what do we know for sure?
We know for sure that when your babysitter tells you that there are ghosts around, you just agree with her until she leaves you alone.
And by the way, what happened with the spirit of the previous governess?
Who knows? I guess that's a question left for us to think about. That's one of the features of psychological realism, leaving the reader uncertain about the accuracy of the events happening.
I think she's probably just traveling from house to house since we're all stuck in quarantine.
I'm born up this country, baby, don't you wanna go? I'm born up the country, baby, don't you wanna go? I'm going to some place.
I hope not. I don't want her anywhere near me. So, Dr. Michelle, what can you tell us about this story?
Henry James, right from the beginning of the story, hints that the story contains a lot of mystery and suspense. The story is told in a dark and stormy day in an old creepy house. In the beginning of the story, there are already some mentions about ghosts, which is an element of Gothic literature. The governess's story starts off with an ambiguity and secrecy, as she doesn't know any details about the place where she works at or about the people she's around. The questions asked by the governess stay unanswered, which hints that there are mysterious elements in the story. With the arrival of the letter from Miles' school, the governess starts to question the reality. The plot does not reveal what has happened to the previous governess or why was Miles, the little boy, suspended from his school, which adds more suspense to the story. The governess quickly develops attachment to the children and is easily overtaken by their innocent appearance. She becomes obsessed with protecting them, which is why one might question the rationality of her behavior. As the genre of the story is psychological realism, we notice the internal conflict within the governess. The story makes the reader question whether the appearance of the ghost is happening in the governess's head or is real. The constant denial of the children and Mrs. Gross about the existence of the ghost makes the reader more suspicious of the governess's mental state and sanity. The constant fear and ambiguity that the governess feels is part of both Gothic literature and psychological realism. In the end of the stories, Flora's sickness and Miles's death leave the reader with the question, with what really happened to them? The sudden appearance of the ghosts and unexpected death of Miles is in unknown circumstances highlights that the supernatural events play a huge role in the story.
Thank you, Dr. Michaud. Since the story was written by two separate authors at different moments in time, despite the overlaps in genres, they have some differences. The structure of The Fall of the House of Usher contains repetitive elements in the beginning of each chapter. However, that isn't the case with The Turn of the Screw. In Poe's story, there was only one narrator, whereas in James's story, there were three narrators. Meanwhile, the governess in The Turn of the Screw was doing everything she could to save the children, believe it or not, even sacrificing herself. In The Fall of the House of Usher, the narrator wanted to help his friend, but was extremely cautious not to get involved. Moreover, the characters of The Fall of the House of Usher were aware of their illness, but in The Turn of the Screw, they were all in denial about the ghosts, except for the governess, of course. While in The Fall of the House of Usher, the story's focus is on Roderick and his sister suffering from an illness and their fears, in The Turn of the Screw, the story's emphasis is on the governess trying to figure out why the ghosts were haunting her and the children.
Very well put, Dr. Ellis, but I couldn't help but notice, what is it with brothers and sisters in odd situations?
What do you mean?
Haven't you noticed? Roderick and Madeline, Miles and Flora, Hansel and Gretel, Dexter and Didi, Thor and Hela, Tanjiro and Nezuko, anyone who is basically a Gemini.
I see your point, but there are also similarities in those stories.
Certainly. Both narrators in the story make the reader confused by constantly stating that they will try to tell the story as accurately as they can remember, which leaves the reader with a lot of doubt. The stories are told by the narrators who have already lived through the events described and now are looking back at them. Narrators arrive at an isolated place in an old, creepy, large family estate. The storytellers arrive at the houses with the intention to help other characters. Both stories contain paranormal elements. The characters of the two stories go through inner conflict, trying to figure out whether there are supernatural creatures existing or whether it's all in their heads. In the two stories, plots revolve around the brother and sister dealing with their inner demons. Sickness is present in the two stories. The appearance of the ghost in both stories results in the death of the main characters. The stories include moods of suspense and mystery, which are important factors in Gothic literature.
I applaud your intellectual acumen, Dr. Michaud.
Well, it's time to wrap this up. Thank you for coming to our show during these dire times of quarantine.
Thank you for having me, and I appreciate our loyal audience for sticking with us in these dark situations.
Remember, everyone, make sure to lock your doors and windows at night before sleeping, so you won't end up like our cameraman.
What happened to him?
Who knows? He just went missing.
Nephew, do you have hand sanitizer? I need to sanitize my hands.
As always, stay safe and tune in with us next week so we can discuss.
Oh, there's someone who wants to join our call. They probably have some questions.
Seven deadlines. You have seven deadlines.
Oh my.
Well, jeez. That was unexpected.
What's with the sassy behavior?
I don't know, girl. That's just rude.
Anyways, folks, don't worry. That was just the spirit of AUA who popped up to remind us about the seven deadlines we have.
Well, she has a point. Let's end this episode here and hopefully we'll see you next week.
Stay safe and don't ghost on us.
Bye.
Goodbye.
Bye.
Take care.
Goodbye.
Stay safe.
Should we just disconnect now?
I don't know. I think it just cuts out on its own.
Told by the narrators who have already lived through the events described. Ես ես երկրորդ անգամ եմ չեմ կարող նորմալ ասեմ, առաջ չեմ ընդրիվ նորմալ ասել։
Okay, ոչինչ, մի հատ էլ գնա։ Հանգիստ ասա, ոչինչ, ի՞նչ կան սխալություններ։ They have some differences.
Okay,
I'll go. Some differences.
Բայց եմ իմ
Ես ինքս ինձ ասել եմ փողը։